Hey everybody, it's your boy Carlos Fraser coming here from Tax Girl Tips, giving you a brief video on the $10,000 business stimulus. So I've seen a lot of videos about it and I've read the tax law and I think I should break it down. So I'm here in the home office. I'm going to give you a quick just overview of a couple of things. I'm going to show you how to qualify for it and the four tests that you have to look out for. So let's jump right into it. All right, so the $10,000 stimulus, it was a really crazy thing. When the law first came out, they said, hey, if you do this EIDL, you'll get $10,000 grant. And what we realized is that, no, you weren't getting the $10,000. You were getting $1,000 per employee. If you were self-employed, only $1,000. So it was a bit of a bummer because you thought you were going to get this money and you realized, oh, I don't really have it. So what happened with the new tax bill that has came through, a new stimulus bill, they changed those rules, and now they're allowing you to get that $10,000. So let's just jump right into it. So this is educational. This is not legal advice. Speak to your own tax preparer or your tax lawyer or tax professional for guidance on your own specific needs, but I want to break it down for you as best as I can. So there's going to be two types of businesses that we're going to be looking at. One that applied for the first round and did not get the full $10,000, and the ones that are applying for the very first time and want to get the grant portion. And remember that, because this is going to be very important while I go through the slides, because there are two types. There's either you've already applied for the EIDL and you did receive that first $1,000, or you didn't receive the first $1,000, but you applied or got rejected. Then there's a second type where you haven't applied at all. So both types of businesses are eligible for this $10,000 stimulus. So you have to pass four tests. There are four tests that you have to pass. And if you don't pass these four tests, unfortunately, you don't qualify for that $10,000 stimulus. So let's jump into those tests. So test number one, you apply for the loan in the first or second round. Easy. You did it. You applied for the loan in the first or second round. Or you applied for the loan by December 31st, 2021. So the first test is either you applied for the loan already in the first or second round, or you are going to apply by December 31st, 2021. Test two, your business has to be located in a low-income community. There are two options that they give you, either the 20% poverty or the 80%, and I'm going to go over that. The low income is based on your census tract, and I guess it's crazy that the census just came out, and we're going right back to the census, but you'll be surprised of how you will qualify, because I live in New Jersey in Maplewood, and I thought, no, there's no way that I'll be able to qualify for this test, but I do. So let's jump into that test. I'll get a deep understanding of it. So per page 2186 of the Act, they basically say a low-income community is the meaning given by 45DE of the Internal Revenue Code. So what they did is they did not try to make up a new meaning of low-income community. They took the tax rebate, the new rebates tax law, and put it into effect. So if you take a look at the 45DE, a low-income community is, in general, has a poverty rate on the census tract of at least 20%, or if you're not located in a metropolitan area, let's say you're in a rural area, you're somewhere like in Pennsylvania that's far from a metropolitan area, your median family income in that census tract cannot be 80% more than the statewide median family income. Or if you are in a metropolitan area, let's say you're in Bushwick, Brooklyn, you have the ability to do the same 80% of the statewide income. So I know it's like, what are you talking about? So let's really get into what that means. So take, for example, I live in the township of Maplewood, and I put in that into my census reporter to get the census tract. And if you take a look at it, Maplewood's income, they have two things. They have the poverty at 5.6 and median household income of $139,000. So for the first one, I definitely don't qualify. The 20% or more, I'm not there. Maplewood is 5.6, so I don't qualify for that. But when you look at the median household income compared to New Jersey's, we're really close, 68%. I'm not exceeding the 80%, so I qualify for that first test. So I qualify for the first test, which is I applied for the EIDL before and only got $1,000 or less, or didn't get a $10,000, and I qualify for the second test where I know that either I live in a census tract that has a poverty rate of 20% or more, or my median income does not exceed 80% of the state. So that's test number two. And just an example, Newark, which is like 10 minutes or 5 minutes away from here, they basically qualify for 20% because their poverty level in Newark, New Jersey is 25%, and the median income is definitely not 80% of the statewide income. So as you can see, you definitely do qualify if you're in that census tract. So take a look at that. Test number three, which I think is actually the hardest test, because test number one, I think is easy. Test number two is fairly easy. Test number three, your business had a 30% drop in gross income from March 2nd, 2020 to December 31st, 2021. Now, it doesn't mean that you look at your March 2nd, 2020, and you look at if it dropped from your March 2nd, 2029. It's not really that simple. When you dig deep into the tax code of how they put it toward in the act, the drop is income over an 8-week period. And I think that's a blessing, because you can pick any eight week period. And I think this is where bookkeeping comes into play, because a lot of people don't have really good bookkeeping and cannot make those ad hoc reports, where if you have like QuickBooks Online, you could easily make those ad hoc reports. But if you don't, you'll have to look at your bank statement and see what that gross income is for that 8 week period in prior year and the 8 week period in the year of 2020. So let's give it an example so you can understand what I'm saying. So example of $30,000. So the first step is you have to find an 8 week period. So in this example, I took March 15th, 2020 to May 14th, 2020. And I compared it to March 15th, 2029 to May 14th, 2029. Gross receipts are $35,000 in 2020. 2019 was $50,000. 30% drop. So that is basically how you look at that 8 week period. And what is going to happen, and I know a lot of business owners are going to have to do this, you're going to have to find, where's the sweet spot for you? What is that 8 week period that's going to work for you? Because it may not be very self-evident, especially if you don't have bookkeeping. But if you do have bookkeeping, you can run a report, especially in QuickBooks, that will look at month to month and compare those months, and you can see which month had a 30% drop in gross income, not net income. We're talking about the gross income that you received after any expenses have even been taken. So test four, the business with less than 300 employees, a non-for-profit with less than 300 employees, or a sole proprietorship, an independent contractor. And the reason I put that in red is because those are the ones, those are the business owners that can benefit the most from this. That's basically almost $9,000 coming your way. So a sole proprietor and an independent contractor, let's take a deep dive at that. It can be basically anything. It could be DoorDash. It could be Postmates. It could be Fiverr. It could be Airbnb. It could be Instacart. It could be TaskRabbit. It could be Wag. It can be, what's another one? Oh, yeah. It could be Lyft, Uber. You have not formed an entity, like an LLC or a partnership or a corporation or a non-for-profit. Or maybe you are an LLC, a single member one. This is for basically the gig workers. The gig workers. This is basically for the gig workers. Barbers, hairstylists, babysitters, dog walkers or sitters, mystery shoppers, get paid for surveys. This is for you. This is what you are trying to get. You're trying to get that $9,000. This is for the side hustlers out there that had the side hustle and you reported it on your tax return. So test number four is what type of entity you are, and that one is fairly clear. So the entitlement to the $10,000. So once again, you applied to the first or second round, did not get the full $10,000, you qualify for the difference. So if you are a sole proprietorship, you did Uber, and you did the EIDL, and you got $1,000, you come back and get the difference, which is the $9,000. or you're applying for the first time and you pass all four tests, you'll get the automatic $10,000 once you go through the application. So those are the ones that are entitled to that $10,000. So you apply for the EIDL and your EIDL and your loan was not approved, you can still get it. If your loan was denied, doesn't matter. We're only talking about the grant portion. You apply for the EIDL loan and you accepted the loan and the grant, you could still get this $10,000 if you did not receive a maximum $10,000 prior. So once again, it's really for those sole practitioners that are out there hustling on the side, you can still get that greenery. So how do you apply? I know that's the question. Like, how do you get this money? And how the law is written in the act, they say the administrator, which is SBA, will provide a notice to each of the following entities stating the entity may be eligible for the payment under this section if the entity satisfies the requirements in clause 1, 3, or 4, which I basically gave you those four tests. If you qualify for those four tests, they will send you a notification. But I think what's really going to happen is they're going to notify you. And per the law, they're saying that business type number one, who has applied before, are first priority, and business type number two are second priority because the credit will be checked. But they're going to send you a notice. And what we've been seeing in the past, that notice is coming electronically. It's not coming by paper. So you have to check your emails and look out for that. And they're going to send you that notice, and you have to reply back because there's no way they're going to know how that 8-week period is going to be. So they're going to have to send you a notice to see that. What is that 8-week period? I don't know if they're going to look at the census tract before they send out the notice, but most people will qualify for that census tract, and most people will qualify for test one because they applied already. So really, like I said before, test three is really the biggest one. That 8-week period, they don't know what it is, so they're going to have to send you notice. So type one, business type one, you do not apply again to the EIDL. They will send you a notice. If you have not applied to the EIDL, you will get, and you will have to apply online on the EIDL application. So verification, they're very clear about the verification inside of the act. The SBA can ask for any type of proof, tax returns, bookkeeping records, proof that you are a covered entity, proof that you are a sole proprietorship, proof that you filed your tax return, proof you are an LLC, proof that you are a corporation, proof that you registered your business, proof of your location of your business, because some people may say, oh, well, I have a home-based business. I live in an affluent neighborhood, but I do all my business in a low-income area. They're going to need to see some type of proof to verify that, and that's usually your business location. So other facts I would like to just jump on. The SBA has 21 days from performing verification, provide payment, and or send notice as to why they denied you. So this goes back to the whole notice thing. I believe that they're going to send a notice out to everyone to get that 8-week period. Then they have 21 days to say that you do not qualify. They'll either look at test one, which makes no sense because test one, you've already applied. They'll look at test two, which is the census tract. They'll look at test three, which is the most important one, looking at the 8-week period. And they'll look at test four to make sure you have less than 300 employees. This is a grant. You do not have to repay this portion. This is will not be considered taxable income. They changed the rules. In the past, it was other income, but now they're saying this is free money. It's not going to be reported as taxable income at all, as be non-exempt income. The EIDL is on gross income. You cannot have a loss. You can have a loss and still qualify. So what that means is that the EIDL looks at the gross that came in. It doesn't look at what's happened after your expenses, only the gross. And that's why I love the EIDL so much, because they're only looking at the money that came in, not the expenses that came out, to see what your net income is. Some other facts is that the, like I said before, the money is free money at the end of the day. And there's no deduction will be denied. So you can take expenses. So if you use that money to pay for business expenses, that will be deductible. And I have, I'll show it up here. I have a video as to how can you use your EIDL. That should be popping up right there. And you can take a look at that. Your tax attributes won't be reduced, your basis won't be reduced. So that's very important, meaning that they won't take it away from anything else. So one other fact, on page 2190 of the Act, this is $20 billion are going to be put to this. $20 billion. And this has to last till December 31st of 2021. So first come, first serve. So if you have not applied for the EDIL, I would say apply for it. I'm going to throw a video up here where I'll show you the step-by-step process on how to apply for this new third round of the EDIL. But I think something that's really important is that they're looking for fraud. It's the Inspector General looking for fraud. So answer those questions very honestly, because they know people are lying and they're going to come and look for it. I have seen at least two people who are not my clients, but they've came into our office and asked us to do some type of certifications because they know that this person may not get the money. So I thank you for listening to the video. Have a great day. And don't forget to like and share.